Okay, so welcome everybody. Thanks for coming. We have a nice intimate group here, so we can be a little less formal. My name's Simon Cole. I'm a professor of criminology, law, and society here at UC Irvine and director of the Newkirk Center for Science and Society. So it gives me great pleasure to introduce this panel for a couple of reasons. One is because it was put together by Professor Bonnie Nardi, and I won't tell the story, but Bonnie got me a job once when I really needed one and helped boost my confidence. And we at the Newkirk Center put together a, when I started at the Newkirk Center, I immediately made her a faculty affiliate of the Newkirk Center. And we asked the faculty affiliates to propose sort of interesting projects for us, and we were really impressed by the proposal that Bonnie and Professor Bill Tomlinson put together, which we thought was really innovative to think about the limits of computing. We think about ecological limits a lot, but we tend not to think about limits of computing. And as our UC Santa Cruz colleague Donna Haraway says, you know, we think of information technology as so light and airy and green, and it isn't necessarily. So they had a great workshop this past spring where they did some great work and workshopped their papers together. And lots of good scholarship is going to come out of this project, and some already has, including a special issue of the online journal First Monday, which did a special issue on Limits 2015, the first workshop on computing within limits. And then we wanted to do a sort of public-facing event, and this is it. So thanks to you all for coming. And our first speaker is going to be Bharath Raghavan from ICSI, which is what?
International Computer Science Institute.
So welcome. Thanks.
So just a note about today, we're going to run through several of our talks, myself, Bill, Don Patterson, who's going to be coming in remotely, Daniel Pargman, Bonnie Nardi, and then we're going to hold a Beehive session where we have discussions around each of the roundtables about the things that we've discussed, questions that arise, and then we can have a Q&A and discussion period at that time. So I'd like to start with why computing must cope with limits. So this summer we convened a few dozen scientists and engineers, computer scientists, to think about the implications of a world of limits on computing. And what I'd like to talk about is some of the context that motivated us to organize this unusual and novel research symposium. And so I'm going to start at a strange place, which is an observation about computer science research, but research in general, that research entails prediction. Now we as researchers don't think about this on a daily basis, but it underlies what we do. You know, researchers do this, the computing industry and industries do this, the foundations that fund research and funding agencies, they do it as well. And the predictions that are made are sometimes implicit, they're sometimes explicit. And they influence what problems we choose to work on, how we solve them, what we think is important or practical research. And often these predictions are about the future. Now in an applied science like computer science, the predictions are about what we think the state of technology might be in 5 or 10 years. And it's not just in research, but in all of computing. So, for example, one of the areas I work in is in large-scale computer networks. And so when I was at Google, I was working on the next generation of what's called software-defined networking for Google's large data center networks. And there we had lots of inbuilt assumptions about what we were going to build. It depended on the hardware that might be available in 2 or 3 or 5 years, the performance and energy constraints that we had, the demands that we were expecting in that amount of time, the energy that was going to consume and how we were going to cope with that. And all of these factors appear in all these different areas. These are a few areas of computer science research I've dabbled in. There are predictions we take for granted. One of the most famous ones, Moore's Law, is from computer architecture, which has forecasted the trend for decades now of faster and faster processors. And so this is what we might call business as usual, the forecast of the constant advancement in each of these fields, the forecast that everyone takes for granted when they're doing their research. Now, this business as usual within technology is actually enveloped by societal business as usual, the expectation in society that we're going to have technological advancement that's built on all of the other things that have been going on since the Great Depression for the last 80 years or so. But computing isn't independent of society, it's part of it. And so the question is, what is the arc we're familiar with? And that's growth. We're familiar with growth in energy consumption, in material resource consumption, in population, in prosperity of various types, and so many other things. And this has been going on for 80 years, and it's intertwined with the technology that we have seen and we now take for granted, the predictions that we now make. But it's not the only arc that societies take. And increasingly, as you all know, many scientists are concerned with other global limits. These are some of the major ones: climate change, fossil fuel depletion, economic dislocation, and social unrest. And so the question is, what if the business as usual prediction, fueled by growth, isn't the only possible arc of the future of society? What might we be ignoring? And if research entails prediction, what global limits affect computing? What's the role of computing in a society with different possible futures? And so we came together to answer and begin answering some of these questions in this workshop that we held in June. Now, I'm not interested in certainty. I like the Yogi Berra saying, prediction is hard, especially about the future. And I'm interested in what we do about it. And so how will society adapt to potential global limits? And so instead of assuming that there is only one possible future, and that's business as usual, perhaps we can consider multiple, and we should hedge our bets. We can consider what's the likelihood of all these different possible futures. And so we might crudely break down future scenarios and then the technology within them into these four categories. I've described business as usual, but in the popular discussion, there are two others that are very commonly discussed. What you might call fast collapse. This is everything from, you know, popular movies where everything crumbles and society withers away, to techno-utopia, where we solve everything with one magical technological solution overnight and all our problems are solved. Now, I can't dismiss either of those, but there's probably a pretty small chance that either of those is going to come about. And so the usual estimate would be that business as usual, let's say 3/4 chance that that's the future we're looking at, and we're going to put most of our effort into that. There are some people who do work on breakthrough technologies, fusion power, you know, advanced solar, and in computing there's all sorts of other sort of techno-utopian potential. But it's not the bulk of the research. And at the other end, there are people who work on how do we make our infrastructure resilient so that it can handle anything. There are people who are looking at those questions as well. Now, the set of challenges, the global limits that we're looking at, imply that this slow decline scenario where things slowly break down, that resources are less available, that climate change causes more chaos, and these chaotic events affect us in various ways, that this is not a non-zero probability, and that we might have a new estimate. We can debate about the exact numbers, but let's say a 1/2 chance that that might happen. How does that change the research that we do? We can still work on all of these, but hedging our bets, we need to think about this slow decline scenario. And so this brings us to computing within limits. Now, 2 to 3 decades ago, we might have said computing really doesn't have any role in responding to these societal challenges. But today, it's clear that it's intertwined with everything in an advanced industrial society. And so that's where we began in June. And so this meeting of minds about these topics, I don't believe has happened anywhere else before among computing researchers or engineers. And so there are lots of lines of thought that are being explored right now among us and among many of the other people that were present there. And one of the questions is, what do we start doing about it? I'm going to give a hint of that, and others are going to expand upon that. One of the main questions that comes up for me is the question of resilience versus efficiency. In most computing systems, and indeed most things in our society, we optimize for efficiency. And there are good reasons for that. But in a system where there is limited resources, say limited energy, resilience becomes valuable. And I'm going to give a few examples of how design constraints motivated by these limits affect the design choices in computing itself. So let's consider a few of these, and I'm going to frame this mostly in the context of internet design because that's the research field that I come from. So today we hear a lot about the cloud and cloud computing, but one of the things that happens when you start pushing things to the cloud is you're actually centralizing your resources. You're consuming a huge amount of power, a huge amount of resources in one place rather than in the distributed locations that we're all at. Our computers which are more powerful than any supercomputer in the 1980s, each of these laptops is mostly idle because the work is happening in the cloud. Our CPUs aren't almost doing anything. But the power in a renewable energy scenario is actually more diffuse. Solar power is everywhere, but it's not concentrated in one location. And so the edge in this scenario is actually least constrained, whereas a large Google data center has to be located next to a massive power plant of some sort. Otherwise, it just can't supply the power it needs. It's hard to build new infrastructure in an energy-constrained scenario. And so we can't assume that we're going to be able to rapidly move to, say, a smart grid, which will solve the energy problems that then mitigate any sort of intermittency that we might face. In most of the data center contexts and also in energy contexts, one of the ways that we deal with the intermittency problem is that we use storage, we use buffering. And so this is both energy storage and data storage. And in both contexts, it turns out that they are one of the most expensive components. Building storage for, say, for solar and wind and for other forms of intermittent renewable power is one of the most expensive parts of the entire system. And so if we assume limited persistence, what does that mean that we have to do in our computing systems? We need to deal with volatility. And just if you think about the packets of data that are going from this laptop here to Don Patterson, who's in Santa Barbara, let alone across the world, all of the routers between this laptop and Don have to have 100% reliable power at all times. We rely on this everywhere, and it's just taken for granted. There are many countries, obviously, in the world that don't have this, and so a lot of the computing systems that we've developed have been difficult to adopt in other places where they don't have 24/7 uninterrupted power. And in a future of, say, intermittent solar power or wind power, it's useful to design the computing systems to deal with volatility. And finally, this again is not a new thing globally, but it might be a new one for us, which is demand exceeding supply. The demand for bandwidth exceeding supply, the demand for energy exceeding supply. How do we cope with that in the computing systems that we design? So those are some of the questions and design principles that I'm interested in. And now I'm going to turn it over to Bill Tomlinson to take from here.
Okay, hi everybody. Thanks for having us here. It's exciting to have an opportunity to present this work that we've been working on. I'm Bill Tomlinson. I'm a professor here in the informatics department. And I'll be talking a little bit more about building systems for use in a future of scarcity. So I'd like to start by backing up, Bharath, and saying that I'd like to assert that we live in a time of great abundance. And if you don't believe me, go watch YouTube videos of people blowing things up with gasoline. Here's somebody being wildly successful at starting a fire using gasoline. I was going to play the full video, but there was quite a bit of cursing, and I wasn't sure it was appropriate for the audience. The power we have at our disposal boggles the mind. The fact that we can create explosions just by going to the gas station. Emperors from 1,000 years ago would say we are all powerful. And yet, I would argue that the wisdom with which we deploy this power is not always, as evidenced here, at the height of human capabilities. So despite this abundance, there is the looming possibility of the reversal of the growth curve that Bharath mentioned. Already there's scarcity in lots of different places around the world, some of them here in the US. And as Bharath mentioned, there is also the possibility of scarcity even here in places right now where we are almost overwhelmed by abundance. So I'd like to offer a few design principles, building on some of the stuff that Bharath was talking about, for designing systems for use in futures of scarcity. So the first one has to do with reducing complexity. And this one is inspired by work by an archaeologist named Joseph Tainter at Utah State University. And he wrote a book in the early 90s. And in it, he looks at many different civilizations across human history. And a commonality that he saw across these civilizations is that people and our civilizations more frequently solve problems by adding complexity than we do by removing complexity. As an instance, we saw sort of a problem in the world that this research topic was not being addressed, and so we made a workshop. This is adding complexity to the world. We live in a very complex world where I think his figure is that there were 500,000 unique types of objects shipped across the Atlantic Ocean during World War II. And that gives you a sense of the scale of different things that are happening in our world. But the fact that we add complexity more frequently than we reduce complexity ultimately leads to an accumulation of complexity, because we don't get rid of it. And complexity has energetic costs associated with it. Putting on the workshop required resources, and all of these different kinds of complexity that we build into our world are energy, they make a demand for energy. And so in the industrialized world, we've been able to accumulate complexity for a very long time, longer than all of us have been alive, 150 years more or less, due to the availability of fossil fuels. We have seen this growth curve because we have had this very great energy source that has allowed us to add complexity rather than reaching any real limits. And as Barath alluded to, growth has been so reliable as to effectively be invisible. We accept it as sort of the fabric of our civilization. However, it's based on fossil fuels. It is not an innate characteristic of human civilizations. And the fossil fuel is not guaranteed to persist into the indefinite future, in fact, far from it. So in designing for futures of scarcity, we need to be aware of the tendency that human civilizations have to add complexity and try to build systems that combat that try to reduce complexity whenever we can. So that would be one potential design principle. A second aspect is focusing on quality of life. And I want to draw an important distinction here between standard of living and quality of life. Standard of living is inherently resource intensive. It's how much money and stuff you have, largely. Quality of life, less so. And there is certainly a correlation. If you take a person who is starving to death and you give them a bag of rice, that is increasing their standard of living and their quality of life in lockstep. But if you take most of the people in this room and give you a bag of rice, it won't make that much of a difference to your quality of life, because everybody in this room is effectively wildly wealthy by global standards. You have like hot running water in your house and things like that, which puts you already in the upper echelon. Many activities in the industrialized world focus on maximizing standard of living. And a core principle that I feel is critical in the design of systems that could help us address these looming civilizational challenges, is to focus instead on quality of life. So taking this together with Tainter, I propose that we need to engage in a principled reduction in social complexity, preserving or improving quality of life, hopefully for humans and other species as well, while reducing our overall resource requirements. A third piece would be to close the loop. So right now, a common way to think about building systems is they take inputs and they produce outputs. And the inputs are often called resources, and the outputs are often called waste. And the waste stream in industrial civilization often ends up in a landfill, or gets burned, or gets piped into the ocean, or goes into some other sort of final resting place. And this model is sometimes called cradle-to-grave thinking, and cradle-to-grave design, where something goes from one spot, it is used, and then it goes off into a waste stream that is sort of out of our purview. But instead, in designing for scarcity, the output of one system should become the input for another system as much as possible. And this is sometimes called cradle-to-cradle thinking, the idea that there are these loops. Rather than having it just be a straight line from inputs to use to output, trying to close the loop and figure out where you can use those resources, use the waste as inputs for a different system. Another one Barath mentioned briefly was handling intermittency. So futures of scarcity often involve intermittent processes. So they might involve rolling brownouts in the electrical grid or intermittent access to clean water. Currently, systems are typically built with the expectation of stable infrastructures. A desktop server doesn't cope well if you just like suddenly turn off the power without giving it a little bit of fair warning. But in these futures of scarcity, intermittency is likely to be a much more prevalent piece of everyday life. And so we need to design in ways that effectively handle that intermittency and degrade gracefully if needed resources become less available. And the final one I want to present is based on the idea that IT is inherently resource intensive. It takes a huge amount of resources to bring IT systems into the world and to use them. And designing for scarcity might require fewer IT systems in the long run. And so therefore, it may be relevant to design systems that help us develop new ways of living, but eventually factor themselves out so that the systems don't need this ongoing IT support. And so we've been calling these kinds of systems self-obviating systems, where they render themselves irrelevant in the long run. In the most extreme case, if one thinks in sort of survivalist terms, which the work we've been doing is sort of very distinct from survivalism, because survivalism has the sort of shotguns and Dinty Moore beef stew type flavor to it that Barth was mentioning. But even in a much slower degradation, we don't have the resources here. Like, if I wanted to make an iPhone, I could not dig up the raw materials for an iPhone in Irvine. It includes coltan, which is mined in the Congo and is leading to civil wars and all sorts of challenges there. We don't have the resources here to build IT in the current forms that we are used to it. And so if we are going to be entering a period of potential scarcity, coming to grips with that and not necessarily having IT systems be as pervasive and ubiquitous as they currently are might be a relevant piece of design. And so our workshop, Limits, back in June, was one of the first gatherings of people who were seriously thinking about some of these issues. And we're glad to have a chance to talk with you about it as well. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to Don, who is on that screen, and unplug, and I think he's going to pop up magically momentarily. Thanks.
Hi, Don.
Hello.
All right, I'm up.
Yes.
And can everyone hear me?
Yes.
Okay. So thanks for me from a distance. I'm currently in Santa Barbara, and I would have loved to have joined you today. I couldn't get the train to go fast enough, however, to get me there after my class this afternoon that ended at 5. It would have had to have been a very fast train. Maybe we'll get that in the future. So what I'd like to do is I'd like to just give you a short presentation about Haiti. This is a result of some field work that we did in February earlier this year, and it was part of a course that we taught as well on some of these issues about limits, myself, Bill Tomlinson, and Bonnie Nardi. So the title of the talk is Haiti's Grid Isn't Smart, It's Futuristic. And we'll talk a little bit about what I mean by that in the next few minutes. So if you, we seem to be inundated with sort of disasters and traumatic events all the time in the media. Haiti had one, if you recall, in 2010. It was a catastrophic earthquake that left hundreds of thousands of people displaced. And Haiti wasn't in particularly great shape before that. And so they haven't really recovered. And probably, recovery probably isn't the thing that they should be looking towards. Just kind of establishing some normal routine is probably a better goal. And this was one of just a continual series of difficult challenges that Haiti in particular has had, some of them caused by political unrest, natural disasters, and economic troubles. And when you go there, which we did, you saw that the problems and the partial solutions are all kind of layered on top of each other. And you see a trajectory and a history of just a lot of different things, both good and bad, that have happened over time that have sort of structured the infrastructure that's present in Haiti. So here's just kind of an example of what it looks like. I think Skype might be a little bit grainy, but what we've got here is we've got some tree stumps in the middle of the public area. And we've got a bunch of goats, which are running all over the tree stumps. And in the background, we have kind of a nice house, actually, that's behind some walls. We've got some graffiti here. And this is just kind of what it looks like in Haiti. There's some public areas that have a lot of leftover stuff, rubble from the earthquake, some rubble from more recent things, but also some nice areas that have been maintained privately, but are sort of separate. And this is another example of some rebuilding effort that's going on after the earthquake. And what we see here is we see a sort of a drainage ditch that used to be a little bit more natural, but it's now being built up with retaining walls out of local stone and some concrete. Although not doesn't look particularly earthquake-proof in this reconstruction. But, despite all this stuff, Haiti continues to go on, and people have moments of joy and, meaning. There are a lot of people in Port-au-Prince, and, they cope with this sort of stuff on a daily basis. So things move on. Meanwhile, in the U.S., as a result of fossil fuel usage, as Barath and Bill have said, we're facing some challenges too with climate change. I like the term weather weirding, which Bill introduced me to, and some increasing costs of energy. And this is going to make it difficult for us to maintain our infrastructures at the level we currently enjoy. So here's an example. Lake Kachuma is particularly interesting to me because it's like about 30% of the water source, maybe 40% of my water source up here in Santa Barbara. And this is a graph over the last 3 years of the capacity of Lake Kachuma. And we're down to 17%. And it's kind of notable, this is associated with the drought, of course, and that backs up to the weather weirding comment. It's kind of interesting because at this level, the water has fallen below the intake pipes for the water, you know, delivery to Santa Barbara. And so there's some extra infrastructure that has to be built to go down lower in the lake in order to supply water. So this is kind of a concern in a lot of ways. So my basic premise of my talk is that Haiti is a viable field site to try and explore how people respond to broken infrastructures. Not that we're gonna experience an earthquake, but that Haiti has layers of broken infrastructure. And by studying what Haitians do to respond to their broken infrastructure, we may be better able to prepare for how to best cope, to use the wealth that Bill, the abundance and wealth that Bill referred to that we've got now, to maybe make some changes so that infrastructure intermittency doesn't really bother us that much. So we can get some of those ideas from what it looks like in Haiti. So that's a basic premise, that Haiti is a good field site for looking at this kind of research. So we did a field trip in February 2015. It was partially relief work, and it was partially to study broken infrastructure, and it was also partially to teach a course on global disruption and information technology that we were teaching at the time. So we did some kind of day camp sort of activities. We also delivered some water filters that were based on kidney dialysis technology to the communities that were rebuilt after the earthquake. When I talk about infrastructures in this next section, which are some of the observations that we made, what I'm referring to is those persistent socio-technical systems over which services are delivered. It's a very vague term, and it really accommodates a lot of different kinds of infrastructures. It's a definition from another researcher. His name is Scott Mainwaring. But it's a good way to think about what we mean by infrastructures and how broad those infrastructures might actually be. We looked at four in particular, water, electricity, communication, and food. I'm sorry, we looked at more than that, but I'm going to try and restrict my comments to those this evening. So water was on everyone's mind in Haiti, and that sort of really resonated with me from California. So this is an example of a typical house here in Haiti, and Haiti has a lot of infrastructure to manage water. So the primary places where water is managed is a big underground tank that holds several days' supply of water, and then a tank that's on the roof, which holds about a day or a few days of water, depending on the usage. And the water gets from the underground tank to the roof through an electric pump. And then when it's on the roof, it gets gravity fed to showers and to kitchen sinks, and then to water filters like the ones that we delivered so that you can drink it. Because the water that's delivered through the city here is not potable. You can't drink it. And in fact, the water doesn't get delivered by the city very regularly. So a lot of times there isn't water from the city. And so alternative ways that water is obtained is through rain. So when rain falls on the roof, it just gets funneled right back down into the tank through pipes to refill the underground tank. So you just drink the rainwater after it's been filtered. The other way that you get water is you can hire tank trucks to come in. I'm going to try and draw a truck. See how I do. So a big water truck can come in and can refill your tank underground, and they can also bring sort of office cooler style water bottles that have been purified other locations. So in this, you see some of the storage and buffering that Barath mentioned. You see electricity moving that pump up. You see nature playing a role in this. And you also see a whole lot of management by the household and making sure that they have water. If you don't have access to that kind of a level of home or that kind of level of water, you can buy water in little bags. Some people got water from surface streams. That's more out in the country. And then the government had installed some water pumps in the city, and this was, so many of them around. Some of them you could drink the water, some of them you could filter the water and drink it, and some of it you couldn't even filter the water and drink them. So the next infrastructure I want to talk about is electricity. After the earthquake, the electricity infrastructure was damaged, and a lot of the infrastructure got rebuilt without traditional infrastructure. So this is an example of a street light that's powered by a solar panel and a battery underneath. Households would have generators. So our household had generators that was powered by fuel. And then we had a whole bank of electrical batteries that would be charged up at night, because city power only came on in the nighttime. So at night, the batteries would get charged up. And then during the day, you would drain down the batteries if you needed electricity. And then every now and then, the city power would come on and you would recharge the batteries. If you needed electricity, your batteries were dead and city power was off, you'd turn on the generator. So again, a lot of buffering, a lot of storage, a lot of control under the homeowner's domain. Communication infrastructure, something very near and dear to the hearts of information technologists, computer scientists. Cell phones were everywhere, but data was very expensive. And charging the cell phones became a management task for people on a regular basis. The Wi-Fi in a home, many homes had Wi-Fi, but instead of having a cable box that was connecting you to a cable company, the connection to the cable company was over an omnidirectional antenna, which means that everyone was sort of communicating to a big radio tower on the top of the hill to get internet for your home. And so needless to say, that would get very congested. And then finally, food. Most of the food, or a good portion of the food in Haiti, is imported. These are a bunch of relief food packages that get distributed by nonprofits. And then some of the food is grown. And this is an example of a street side vendor who is selling some food that they were able to grow on the countryside or in their homes or in their yards. So those are the four infrastructures that I wanted to talk about. I wanted to just draw out some interconnections and some disconnections and then draw some conclusions. There were a lot of interconnections in these infrastructures. You couldn't get water without electricity because of that electrical pump. After a few hours, maybe a day, that tank on the top of your house would run dry. And if you didn't have electricity, you couldn't pump from your underground tank to the roof. Of course, electricity had to come from batteries, if you had that, or generator, or the power from the city, if that was on, but it was complicated. Turns out you also couldn't get data without electricity, because of course your router needed electricity, but you also needed to charge up your computers, and the tower that was receiving your signal had to have electricity. But you couldn't get electricity without fuel, because if you needed your diesel generator to operate, you had to be able to get down to the gas station to pick up fuel in order to run it. On the other hand, there were some disconnections. So for example, when it rained, it turned out that you received water, and that was great because you refilled your underground water supply. But that tended to break your data connection to the tower on the top of the hill because the rain and the atmospheric conditions broke that infrastructure. And of course, when you used data, you lost electricity because you were wearing down batteries that you had to charge. And when it rained, you couldn't get fuel because the roads were all muddy and made going out in a car or walking kind of something you only did if there was an emergency when it was raining. Because of these interconnections and disconnections, people had different rhythms. They changed their lives in relation to these connections. You would start uploads at night when there was plenty of bandwidth and power was on, and you'd finish your downloads overnight. When it rained, you'd socialize because there was no internet and the roads were muddy. So the first of two observations then is that intermittent infrastructures, they change your daily rhythms, and they actually change your local culture as well. The things that you do in response to these infrastructures vary. And as I pointed out, that as infrastructures break, the amount of infrastructure that people took on to manage became greater. So the stuff on the right of this bar represents what local people were taking care of instead of like infrastructure providers like your power company. And as the infrastructures got more intermittent, you became more responsible for getting a tank of gas, for having more batteries, for having bigger water tanks. Second observation is that infrastructure breaks down, end users do more labor to ensure that your services work. So what about computers? In Haiti, there weren't very many computers, or there were very few or simple that were involved in the infrastructures. And it was people that enabled the infrastructures to stay flexible. Our infrastructures are imbued with computers. And it's an interesting question about whether we will be able to be as flexible when we have similar intermittency. Finally, are we really facing this? Is this really a case study of something that we should be concerned about? I want to show you a picture of something I saw yesterday. This is a water truck that was delivering water to a home in Mount Montecito. I was just really struck by the fact that although we're coming from a position of wealth, even more so from Montecito, they have hired water trucks to come bring water to their homes. Of course, it's not to drink, but it's to irrigate their landscape. So they want, you know, the people want to be responsible with the local water supply. I don't know where this water truck got its water tank water from, but you can see that the response that we're having when we have low water is starting to look a lot like Haiti, although our position of wealth means that there are some differences as well. So here's some provocations. I feel like I'm a little over time, so I'll let them stand. But we see some things like the Tesla home battery that are pointing to a future like this. So thank you for your attention.
So I'm the last speaker. I'm Daniel Parkman, and I'll give you a view from Europe. I don't know exactly how much of this will be specifically European, but you could see that I lingered on the menu, so you could see my sort of Swedish operating system, which you didn't understand anything of, if you were, yeah. So, and it will be more about limits and slightly less about computing, but I'll sort of tie back in the end. Ordinarily, I'm in Stockholm at the Royal Institute of Technology at School of Computer Science and Communication. I'm also working at a research center working specifically with ICT and sustainability. And I will start with this picture, which you all recognize. It's the Earth from, it's taken from the Apollo mission, Apollo 11. And the point, the take-home message here is that you should realize that we live on a finite planet that isn't growing, it isn't shrinking either, fortunately. We have finite resources here. So to some extent, unless we manage to close the loop, what we use today is sort of gone tomorrow or dissipates, become part of the waste stream. Also, we're kind of stuck here. So we really have to make a go at making it work. So the finiteness of this planet sort of contradicts some of the curves that we see all around us of exponential growth. Starts slowly and then starts to rise dramatically. Population, economic activity, paper consumption, McDonald's restaurants, tourism, you know, wherever we look, we can see these curves. They start 1750, and many of them, perhaps most of them, actually sort of the knee of the curve when they turn upwards is around 1950s or something like that. A view from Europe, the one topic that we are discussing all the time right now in Europe in general, and I would have to say in Sweden in particular, is the so-called European refugee crisis, the European migrant crisis. This is the official picture from the Swedish Migration Agency's homepage, People on the Run. So we'd like to think of ourselves as a humanitarian superpower, I would say, in Sweden. But we are facing some challenges now. There were around 600,000 people crossing the Mediterranean last year, and that figure will rise by 50% or so this year. And quite a few people are aiming or going to Sweden. Germany is another, is the biggest country in accepting refugees right now in Europe. But I should also mention this term, the European refugee crisis, it has kind of a double meaning. It refers both to the underlying condition that actually make people flee from their home countries, and also the challenges for different European countries to take care of many immigrants in a short time period. About half of the people coming to Europe right now are from Syria. So I will talk about three different limits, and the first one will connect to refugees and asylum seekers. So As I said, we've done our very best to welcome as many people as possible, but we've kind of met our limits. I know that you have a fierce debate right now about Obama promised that the US will accept 10,000 Syrian refugees next year, up from 2,000. Mm-hmm. This is the number of asylum seekers in Sweden per month the last 5 years. And you can notice that 10,000 per month, we had that last summer, and this summer, late summer and autumn, it just exploded. We actually had 10,000 asylum seekers coming to Sweden per week at the end of October and beginning of November. And Sweden is a quite small country. We have 10 million inhabitants, so it's kind of the size as Michigan or Georgia or North Carolina, who all have about 10 million people living there. But we did reach our breaking point. We will have had around 200,000 asylum seekers coming to Sweden at the end of this year. And the Swedish Migration Agency said actually only 2 weeks ago that they can't really offer shelter to all asylum seekers. Basically, they can't find enough places with a roof because of the ongoing pressure of 10,000 people showing up per week. So either you have to trust the general public or non-governmental organizations, or you have to kind of know someone, compatriots or relatives, but we will try to give priority to families with children. Another limit that we're facing here is we're actually really proud, again, as a humanitarian superpower. I don't know if I'm 100% serious when I use that or if it's tongue-in-cheek, but we'd like to think of ourselves that way. And we've managed to actually give 1% of our gross domestic product in foreign aid since the mid-70s. But now we're sort of redirecting some of that money to kind of fix this problem at home. And there's actually talk of redirecting more than 50% of the foreign aid to handle the refugee crisis. So stepping back and lifting this problem to another level, I'll discuss the second limit, and some of the previous speakers have already mentioned that, and that is our use of energy and fossil fuels. This is our use of fossil fuels since during the last 250 years. First coal, then red oil, and also natural gas. And you can see again this exponentially growing curve that starts from nothing and then rises, aiming for the sky. And I'd like to ask, you know, how would we imagine the next 100 years? Could this continue further? And actually, I really can't, because these are all non-renewable resources. What we use today is gone tomorrow. So it's more probable that, or it's actually a certainty that these curves at some point, and we can discuss when, but at some point they kind of have to change the direction. You might have heard the term peak oil, but of course all non-renewable resources will eventually reach their peaks. So that is the point in time when the production just can't increase and it will sort of level off and then decrease. And the US was the largest oil producer for the major part of the 20th century, but for the US, the peak in oil production actually happened in 1970, and it's been declining since. And there might be some ups and some downs, but the general direction is downward. So the first oil crisis in 1973, the US at that point imported 10% of the oil. Now it's a lot more. This is something that we don't discuss a lot. We actually perhaps don't even see it. And to illustrate that, I have a great quote by an author, Richard Heinberg. He said, 10 years ago almost, projecting into the future, he said, "Yeah, yet people won't really talk about the peak in oil production. Instead, they'll be talking about lots of what they perceive to be current problems, like the high unemployment figures and the high price of food or the high price of airplane tickets. They'll be talking about, this is very timely, the latest war or the latest terrorist incident, and they will have completely lost sight of the one event that has caused all of those effects." So that's the production of oil or fossil fuels. We also have to think about the tail end, the tailpipe? well, what comes out in the other end, which is that when we burn fossil fuels, we have carbon emissions. This is another underlying sort of a connection that oftentimes isn't really made or that is drowned, but that is a possible connection between climate change and war, for example, civil war. These are some of the headlines from the National Geographic, The Guardian, The New York Times, Washington Post, and Time magazine. And I think the one in the middle kind of says it all. Researchers link Syrian conflict to a drought made worse by climate change. This is a very bleak perspective. It also implies that we might see more of these types of low-level, low-intensive conflicts that sort of like drag on. I think that this bleak vision has been formulated best by a German sociologist called Harald Welzer, who wrote this book in 2007, Climate Wars, Why People Will Be Killed in the 21st Century. And the reasons are as follows. This is another quote from the book. We will have lots of struggles over drinking water, perhaps agricultural land or fish in the ocean or other resources. Civil wars also in some of the poorest countries and endless flows of refugees. These are the new conflicts and forces shaping the world of the 21st century. Rich countries are already developing strategies to garner resources and to keep climate refugees at bay. So just on track, actually, earlier this week, the European Community struck a deal with Turkey. They should limit the flow of refugees because many of the refugees I mentioned, they come from Syria to Turkey and from Turkey to Europe. So Turkey will receive some political concessions, including sort of a half promise to think about membership in the European Community, as well as 3 billion euros in return for clamping down on their borders and keeping refugees inside Turkey. When Harald Welzer wrote this in 2007, he was actually referring to the deal we had at that time with Libyan dictator Muammar Gaddafi, who it became unfashionable to collaborate with him a few years later. But at that time, we kind of had the same deal to keep refugees out of sight and out of mind. So, what to do? A few conclusions and suggestions, perhaps. So fossil fuels are a problem, both obtaining them and the end product of using them or using them up. So a quote from the chief economist of the International Energy Agency from 2008-2009, he has said it several times afterward. He says, we have to leave oil before oil leaves us. That's very good advice. And in this context of this talk this evening, we might think of what the effects will be of a world with where we do leave oil. So what will computing look like in the future? What will be the challenges of adapting our infrastructure or information technologies to a world where we leave oil, switch to perhaps to a much larger extent, switch to renewable resources? Another very timely problem, I mentioned the European refugee crisis. So how can we help refugees? How can we integrate immigrants? There's this term that has been floated lately, refugee tech. So how can we use, for example, mobile technologies, Google Maps, social media, data analytics, perhaps even drones, in this context? How can we use these technologies to help refugees, to help governments, to help private companies get through the crisis as quickly and as effectively as we can? Now, the last picture or pictures, I'll show you a picture of good times. So this graph needs some explanation. This is the price of electricity, a fixed amount of electricity, actually 1 kilowatt hour of electricity in Sweden from 1892 until, you know, today, basically. But it's not really Swedish crowns or dollar or anything on the y-axis, it's actually the number of minutes that the average Swedish worker has had to work to be able to buy 1 kilowatt hour of electricity. And as you can see, it starts at more than 2 hours. You need to work more than 2 hours to buy 1 kilowatt hour, and then it drops precipitously. And somewhere in 1970, you can't even see what the price is. It looks like it's almost nothing. So by changing the scale to logarithmic scale, we get a better grasp of what we're seeing. And what we can see is that basically what this remarkably straight line, the story behind this remarkably straight line is that for every decade, 7 decades in a row, the price of this fixed amount of electricity was decreased by 50%, and then 50% again, and then 50% again, and so on. Falling below 1 minute, you had to work less than 1 minute to buy 1 kilowatt hour of electricity in the 60s, sometimes in the 60s, it's cost a fraction of a minute. In now, it's hard to imagine how much 1 kilowatt hour of electricity is, but that's basically 13 hours of physical work for a human being if you generate that electricity or that energy yourself. And I'll finish with a few questions. So is the coincidence that computers, the internet, has come about in an age during the last 40, 50 years when we had cheap energy, perhaps even energy that is almost too cheap to meter the promise of nuclear energy originally in the 50s. And we might have lived with that for a couple of decades. Are perhaps computers and the internet and related technologies to some extent also built on the premise of cheap technology? And if so, what would happen if energy would no longer be cheap? And I'm not talking about tomorrow or next year, but during the next decade or two. So that's the question that I leave you with. Thank you very much.
We should probably go ahead and take some questions and
do you mean specifically with regard to the refugee crisis, or with regard to the entire?
The entire limits and resources and the impact on the environment that we talked about, including computing, but how do we take the curve from doing this to changing the whole curve?
Yeah, I mean, there certainly is a huge political and social aspect to it, and that is, it's an unsolved question how to enact social transformation at that scale. Maybe it is a political phenomenon, but maybe that would be a viable solution, but I don't know quite how to do that shy of enlightened dictatorship, which has its own set of concerns.
Just start a corporation.
What's that?
Just start a corporation.
Just start a corporation? Oh, okay. Yeah.
I'll just add as a quick aside is that, you mentioned the Tesla home batteries. When are people going to start buying those? I mean, Irvine companies buying Tesla batteries for their office buildings now. Mm-hmm. They've made an order for like 25 buildings, so it's happening. And you can just give that to the Irvine company to throw people in, and you have a model for resilient structures.
Well, that is an interesting thing. I think this is coming from something that Don told me a while back. He did some field work in Africa a number of years ago, and Don, I don't want to speak out of turn, but I think it was you. Where in certain parts of Africa, people are more loyal to the corporations that support their resources than they are to the government, because the government doesn't do much for them. So they're like, they would first be like Vodafone people before they are members of a certain country. And so that's going back to the point you're making of like, start a corporation, like,
Forget about tax-exempt charitable organizations. They don't respond to those. What this political environment responds to is corporate. So design it through a corporation. Protect yourself using the corporate tools and attack using the corporate tools. Develop that way. The point we did discuss at this table was, what about the financial environment? You didn't touch on it, and I think it was a real failing. Because no matter how many alternative energy credits you create, if you have an institution that is selling those credits, not only to your state and your city, but outside to the highest bidder, it will defeat local development of alternative energy at every turn. You have to deal with the financial realities of who the players are. in this field, is you need to succeed, which you do. You know, you have to think about how what the tax consequences are, what the tax credit energy people are doing.
I guess one way that I try to think about these things is that as computer science, we can think of ourselves as computer scientists and researchers, and then also as citizens. And I find it difficult to wear both hats simultaneously because some of the problems, as any of you have discussed, is political. But as a computer scientist, there are certain things I can do to influence that. But in a large part, I want to respond to whatever may come out of our political process, good or ill. So if we respond to the problems, that's great, but a lot of analyses show that it's almost too late to completely replace everything with renewable energy in time. If you look at a lot of the analyses, there's a good one from Tom Murphy, a professor at UC San Diego, of how long it would take to build out the renewable energy infrastructure. It would take 20 or 30 years to replace what we use today, the 18 terawatts globally. And so, you know, we're going to be facing some amount of intermittency, some amount of the problems that we're discussing. So we're going to have our hands full of engineers and as citizens. But, you know, I'd like us to apply our wisdom on the building better infrastructure to respond to these situations.
Don has his hand up.
Yes, thanks. I just want to think that maybe you could think about the political and the economic environment as infrastructures also. And that maybe the kinds of things that we're thinking about with electricity, we think about the political and financial infrastructure such that they're also going to be intermittent. And we may also need to take on board more of the work that we're used to getting from financial infrastructures or from citizen infrastructures. We're maybe going to have to do more of that in order to keep those processes running. It's just another way, kind of thinking about it as an infrastructure maybe allows us to bring in some of the observations that we've seen in other kinds of infrastructures into that mode.
I think a multidiscipline approach is what you are striving for, so why not have some financial people available to you when you're building your models? They can at least talk about the energy credit aspect, which will allow many of the projects you've discussed to move along or to die in its tracks.
Yeah, that's a really good idea. Next year when we do the workshop in June again, we're going to bring in experts, so we should consider somebody who knows about finances. That's an excellent suggestion.
Okay. And I just also want to encourage you to look at the corporate structure versus a charitable organization, humanitarian organization. It's very hard for them to succeed. We all know some that have, and they're spectacular. But why not fight the enemy on its own soil?
But by corporate versus a charitable, you're talking about profit. Is that
maybe
a distinguishing
that could easily be a goal of a corporation to make a profit? It doesn't have to be, but it is something. Usually, corporations are designed to engage in any activity allowed by the state in which they are incorporated. Therefore, they can dispense funds, they can fund research, they can run trials. They could build an institution like FDA and have laboratories everywhere and just have people sample out their ideas, cycle them through. A corporation can be formed.
How does that distinguish a corporation from the NIH?
I'm sorry?
How is that different than what NIH does?
Funding, for one, and how funding from, and NIH gets its funding from a very clear avenue. Corporations have to go out and raise it. So if you were to say, I want to build a model of survival of technology and the functional systems that would be needed by humanity and the circumstances, and go out and try to do a fundraiser on the web, you might succeed. But if NIH tried to do that, they probably would not be believed, or people would doubt their intentions, potentially.
Simon has had his hand up for a bit, and I want to make sure that here's a chance. But
thanks, Bill. there's a taboo word that has not been mentioned, which I think is absolutely fundamental here. I'm reminded of a quotation from Kenneth Boulding. This is from 1956, where he said, anyone who believes in indefinite growth of anything physical on a physically finite planet is either a madman or an economist. And not just an economist, but a capitalist.
Right.
And the dirty word is capitalism. And you know, Bill reminded us that growth has been so reliable as to be invisible, and that's partly due to the profligate exploitation of fossil resources from deep in the planet, but it's also due to a political theory. A political theory that 50 years ago was obvious to me was completely unsustainable. And so I'm confused that we're having this conversation now, not 50 years ago, frankly. So, you know, let's not forget. And also there's a parochiality to this conversation. Most of the world lives with intermittency all of the time. 80% yeah. of the planet, the first thing they do in the morning is get water. Right? I grew up in a town, in a city, in a westernized country, where there wasn't sewage. There wasn't piped sewage systems, and there were trucks and cans and smelly men. I grew up seeing windmills, which when the wind blew, pumped water out of bores and into tanks. You know, most of the world runs like this. Mm-hmm. And I'll tell you a story. I was in Varanasi in 1986. I was a callow youth. I walked into a bank, and there was a room twice this size with men with ledgers. And I talked to the teller behind the desk, and I said, you know, dude, two PCs could do the work of all these people. And in his wonderfully polite way, he said, well, sir, you see, in India, we have no desire to reduce the number of jobs. And in any case, we only have electricity 2 days a week. This is the whole world. We're the ones that are out of step.
Thank you, Sam. Okay, other tables, comments, questions?
That didn't represent my table. I'm sorry. Same
table.
That's really interesting that came out of our little discussion regarding the political environment. We were discussing how in California the governor has mandated that residential water use be reduced by 25%. And we thought it was a little bit silly in that residential water use represented less than 5% of total use in the entire state. But it produced an interesting effect in that people, stopped watering their lawns. And this created a sort of social cohesion around the idea that, okay, water's a problem, and even though in the aggregate we're not really saving that much water by not watering our lawns, but at least it's creating a visible effect that, okay, we're changing the political environment a little bit, that we're actually beginning to address the water.
Uh-huh.
I just have one more comment. Something you also might want to add to your design is when you go to a place like Haiti, you need to gather the people who have skills or somehow categorize them and retain connectivity to them. You know, how do you get to them? How do you get them to the source of the problem so they might fix it or contribute to thinking it through? So you need to create a centralized communication base that allows all these common people to sign up, alert others to their skill levels, et cetera, and maybe even a little job history.
Or were they good at doing that on their own without having to go to a centralized place?
Your experiences in Haiti, did they have any common telephone book for the plumbers, the gardeners, the laborers?
Oh, Don's muted. You're muted.
Don, you're muted. We lost sound.
Sorry. So the question was, is there a common telephone book?
For skill-based populations.
Well, there were a lot of people that had specialized skills. And you came to, they kind of had this handyman sort of flavor, where you would kind of have your network of people that you knew that could do different things. They often weren't formally trained. They just sort of had developed a skill at, you know, metal work, or you would hire drivers or security people, and they kind of filled a niche that way. But I don't recall there being like a registry. It was much more word of mouth, at least in the things that I saw.
Okay.
Was that the question?
It is in a way, you know, but over a larger territory, as you said, Haiti is quite small. If we're looking at Southern California suffering a major blow, similar to what Louisiana took during one of the big storms, you need to have people who can work on air conditioners over to the hospital operating area so that they can control that situation as early as possible. You need logistical information
support.
And support, yeah. And well, the aid agencies already have a lot of this. So if you were to incorporate this data in your models, you have resources you can go to today. The aid agencies who are actively in the field, Doctors Without Borders, these guys know how to do it, how to deliver services to remote locations, and they must have a way of organizing the local people by their skill groups. And you might incorporate it in your model.
Yeah, I mean, definitely the skills of people is something that has come up again and again. At least, you know, I think Bill and I in particular have talked about how, you know, you need a community in order to get through these things, and that needs organization at some level.
Mm-hmm.
One other thing I'd add is that what Don's talking about in his research area, and I've dabbled in a little bit, there's a parallel field of research called ICT for development.
Right.
Computing for developing regions. And a lot of the concerns that we're interested in the limits context, are very similar to the developing regions context, places that already have broken infrastructure, but we're just considering what happens when we go from working infrastructure downward. And so the term I often think of is undeveloping regions, places that start at what we think of as first world status and slowly degrade. And there, we can think of many examples globally that are facing this. Financial crisis in Greece has caused a massive decline in their GDP and their infrastructure. And they're going from a position where people don't know how to cope with those things, they haven't had to they're creating the informal infrastructures like what Don was talking about.
And as tempting as it is to want to go in and like fix Haiti or fix Greece, I feel like it's a better approach to try and fix our own problems and prepare for our own future and collaborate and see how can we both draw on each other's experience in navigating these infrastructures. I just feel a lot better about that than trying to fix Haiti's problem when I'm not really Haitian and I'm honestly just not going to live there and deal with the implications of what I think might be great, but maybe they don't think is great.
Well, Haiti is only one of your study goals, but state of Vermont, for instance, just a couple of years ago, suffered a terrible storm. Many of the towns, several towns, were totally isolated from the rest of the state because of water damage to roads, et cetera, et cetera. Those people were able to find the resources within their own township, who had the bulldozers, who had the gravel, who lived on what road, and how, if you could get over that road, or did you need to take the logging road, da, 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 da. And they were able not only to survive, but to fix most of the problems themselves and then merely accept aid from the state after the job was basically done and they had cured their own problem. So when you find a disaster in America, more convenient disaster potentially to study this society, go to it and find out how those local townspeople and those little cities have survived and rebuilt quickly. And I can give you this, my own little town, which was one of the towns that was entirely isolated. And there were several in the state of Vermont. You can look it up, it's public information.
There's a distinction that I think is significant here that we've talked about in a couple of papers previously. There's another field called crisis informatics that does the things that you're talking about. That's Laser Palin and at the University of Colorado is one of the main people on that. One of the differences we see is that as industrial civilization, if it were to go into a slow descent, a big difference between crisis informatics and what we're talking about is that in crisis informatics, there's sort of an other that you can rely on not being collapsed, that you can go to for support, or that is, you know, has the buckets of water that can send to you, in a way that the way in which we're formulating this is a little bit more like big chunks of industrial civilization would be going out at the same time, such that there's not this sort of outside entity that you can count on. It's not just getting over the hump. It's like we're all going in this direction together. So I feel like you're asking very interesting questions. I feel like they're addressing sort of a different field than what we're precisely after, I think.
And again, in the case that both in Haiti and in the Vermont cases that we've been discussing, they have land. They can take resources off the land. People who live in cities, which assumedly is part of your study, they have very little of the traditional infrastructure left. They'll still have chunks of concrete that they might be able to build houses out of, you know, maybe damaged roads that they may be able to drive down if they had to, on and on and on. But it's a very different survival scenario.
I might say, though, that, I mean, especially given that we're coming from a computing point of view, what Bill mentioned, that in Vermont or in Irvine, nobody's going to be able to build an iPhone using local resources. It's just not going to happen. There's no infrastructure to build it. The manufacturing facilities, the resources don't exist in one place. One of the studies I did a few years ago is we tried to figure out what is the material base of the internet. If I wanted to build long distance communication, what would I have to do? And so I said, okay, I need these kinds of components. I need routers, I need computers. What do those need? What are the manufacturing processes? I built this crazy diagram that goes 10 levels down, and at the bottom are elements. Here's aluminum, here's silicon, here are all the different things that come out of the ground. And then we said, okay, where do these exist on the planet? And it, you know, it colors up the planet because you need the resource base of the planet, manufacturing facilities across the planet. This is the, you know, to do long distance communication, the basic version of it. And so then the thought was, okay, well, how do we shrink that base? And I think that's the sort of longer term thinking. One of I'm gonna mess up the quote, the building systems in the abundant present for a future of scarcity, one of the lines from a paper that they all wrote. That's the sort of longer term building new infrastructures that will slowly replace what we have today.
I mean, one good thing that came out of the Haiti crisis was a very much more developed map of Haiti. There was a lot of collaboration through OpenStreetMap of doing that. Even though it was a crisis situation, there, the street maps were mapped out and they weren't before. And so that is something that actually remains. And that becomes a resource now that can be drawn upon that is very information technology centered and really help them, is gonna help Haiti to prepare for the next thing that happens. And so that's sort of an interesting, you know, good thing that came out of the earthquake that is smack in the middle of the information technology domain.
Mm-hmm. I just wanted to, I'm tagging on to this question of the globalization of our manufacturing economies. There's a TED talk by a guy by the name of Thomas Thwaites, an artist who built his own, who went, set out to build his own toaster. And it's a ghastly piece of garbage, but it's a kind of performative experiment in precisely what you're talking about. And the thing is that the global trade infrastructure is fully integrated into our economies. If any piece of that drops out, add to which I don't think we usually notice this, but that oceanic trade network, the supertankers and container ships, are the most polluting mode of transportation on the planet. In fact, the 15 biggest container ships on the planet produce as much sulfur dioxide as all the automobiles on the planet.
We had some questions from this table.
There are a couple of tables have raised issues having to do with the financial environment or economic system or indeed capitalism itself. One, two, three different tables. So I recall a quote from cultural critic Frederick Jameson. He has said, "It's easier for us to imagine the end of the world than for us to imagine the end of capitalism." It's really strange. So we have lots of movies. Either things work exactly like they do today, or everything fails simultaneously and from one day to the other, kind of Mad Max scenarios. In the same way, it's easier for us to imagine that we will leave Earth and colonize other planets than for us to actually fix the problems we have on this planet, where there are 7 billion people. That's really a lack of imagination. That's another limit. Limits to our imagination to imagine alternative economic systems, for example. So I agree, we should definitely look for and team up with renegade economists to discuss possible futures too.
Just wondering what you put it in perspective. How much percent of the world's energy budget is all in the world?
I did a study on this to try and understand. I first carved it off to the internet, and then I considered all end devices in this. And so it's about 2%. But one of the things that I included in this was actually the manufacturing of the devices, because that usually gets left off. And so that actually is 50% of the energy consumption of IT is the energy to make the devices. Because what you do is you take the amount that it takes to build this and divide it by its replacement lifespan, and you have effectively a power consumption figure, which you can then equate with the power consumption from the wall socket. And so 2% is not huge in the global scheme of things, where if we use it wisely, then we can maybe offset some of the larger consuming things in the world.
It's growing fast, though.
It is growing fast.
It's growing faster than lots of other parts.
I've heard 7% as sort of a topping out.
I know another study that says 3% for ICT and media.
Yeah, we're probably getting up to 3% now.
Do you think that the Internet of Things, which everybody talks about, is going to increase this a lot, or is it not going to use that much data storage and
I think the Internet of Things, and this is one of the weird sort of parallel trends that we might see, and this is totally speculation, is that we will see the Internet of Things for fewer and fewer people, or fewer and fewer places. That the technology will advance, and as Daniel was talking about, a friend of his who loves the latest gadgets and has a fridge that will tell him on his smartphone how many times the fridge has been opened and is tracking this kind of data.
My father would have loved
and
that.
There are a lot of projects like that.
Hack your fridge, hack everything else.
Actually, you can. There have been studies of how certain Samsung fridges were insecure, so you could hack in and take somebody's email account through their fridge.
Mm-hmm.
So the Internet of Things is definitely happening, but it seems that there are fewer people who will both need it or want it as limits become more of a problem. The question is, can we redirect some of the energy that researchers, our colleagues, are putting into that and say, maybe there's some other interesting problems you can work on that are as interesting as the next smart fridge.
Okay, well, let's wrap up. I want to thank the speakers for their great talks. And I want to thank the Newkirk Center for Science and Society for supporting us. Thank you very much. And thanks to Lori, who's in the back, who helped us with all the organizations. And thank you very much.